Hodder and Stoughton Limited present Deadly Game by Michael Caine, read by Eddie Marsan. Chapter 1. When Dave looked back and remembered seeing the box for the first time, he could have sworn it had been glowing. Well, he couldn't be sure. He was a bit hazy about the whole thing, truth be told. What with the concussion, the general commotion that had rumbled around him for what seemed like hours, and the state of his nerves in general. But that's what his memory told him, or started to tell him, days after it happened. A sort of low glimmering around the edges of the black metal. Even now, in a lumpy hospital bed, waiting for the x-ray and the results of the other tests that the doctors were a bit vaguer about, he couldn't quite piece it together. The whole thing made next to no sense, especially the speed and the violence with which it had all happened. One minute he was making a phone call, the next he was being woken up by half of Uniform London, asking him again and again if he was okay, and could he tell them just once more, please, sir, what exactly he had found and how. Dave looked down at the frayed gown they had put him in, the usual embarrassing hospital uniform, the drab spotted pattern barely visible in the grey-white fabric. There was a cannula in the back of his hand and a bunch of drips at the bedside. "Just till we've got you back on your feet," the nurse had assured him. Where were his clothes and boots, his phone? Had they told Jess like it asked? She and the kids would be sick to death with worry. But every time he tried to get an answer or pull himself together, the dull haze of clinical shock reasserted itself. All he knew for certain was that somebody, somehow, was using a hammer drill inside his skull, or at least that's what it felt like. And that, whatever he and Terry had stumbled into that morning, was, somehow or other, for someone somewhere, very bad news indeed. As Dave had told any number of coppers, uniformed at first, then in a hazmat gear and finally in suits, it had been a day like any other, until it had stopped being that in any shape or form, if they caught his meaning. He had arrived at the hut at 8 o'clock as usual, got a brew on and waited for Terry, who always turned up at 8:10 on the dot, in his high-vis jacket, T-shirt, paint-spattered jeans and weathered Doc Martens. Terry was the tougher-looking of the two, though Dave was, they both knew, stronger. When it came to hauling a beam of timber or a loose headboard off the back of an open truck, it was always Dave who took the lead. Most of the job was lifting and sorting, heaving stuff from open-back lorries and transits into the dump, and then, after a fashion, putting everything into the right pile, ready for recycling. This is what the council rules required, though Dave had never seen much evidence of the half-hearted sifting and categorizing making any difference. The piles got bigger, the world turned, and nothing much changed. The dump was 5 minutes' walk from Stepney High Street and surrounded on three sides by old warehouses, two of which were being converted for office use. The other side, next to the road, was hemmed in by a 20-foot-high chicken wire fence, with a gate big enough to allow vehicles to reverse and a few fake CCTV cameras to put off tramps and druggies. Very occasionally, somebody made it over the top and was found sleeping their previous evening off on a decaying Chesterfield sofa under a tarpaulin. But the odds were seriously against anyone who needed that kind of accommodation that badly being able to scale the fence in the first place. Terry had once found one of the local street girls and her John passed out on a mattress balanced on top of one of the rubbish heaps. He wasn't sure whether to compliment them on their athleticism, even if they had been turbocharged by Keto's speed, that was a proper climb, or to read them the riot act, which he knew he was supposed to do. Instead, it just told them warily to sling their hook. As it said to Dave later, he'd rarely seen a hook slung faster. More often, They found stuff that had been hurled over the top in the night, fly tipping, big sacks of noxious garbage, smaller items of furniture or household tat, rotten meat, fish, fruit and veg dumped by market stall traders or restaurant staff on their way home. On those days, you rarely needed your face mask. Sometimes the morning catch was plain weird. A big box of wigs, that'd been a good one, and a medical teaching skeleton slumped by the gate when Dave arrived. Anyway, one of them always did the rounds first thing and checked it off on the clipboard. It was part of the routine and required by council bylaws. Health and safety, like almost everything else that shaped their day. Just another box to tick before the scheduled morning deliveries from around the borough began around 9 o'clock. That morning, Dave set off on his quick tour of the site, leaving Terry engrossed by a row on Talksport between Laura Woods and Ali McCoist about Spurs. Stepping out of the hut, Dave was struck by what a lovely morning it was turning out to be. The sky cloudless and resolutely blue, but with a nice breeze cooling his brow as he trudged through the rubble, rust and ruin. There was a football by the furniture pile, not for the first time. It must have been accidentally kicked into the dump by kids playing in the street the previous evening. He took a run up, aiming for a beige leather armchair about 20 metres away, and caught the ball with just the right part of his boot. Goal! He raised a fist in celebration. A good omen for the day, surely. Or maybe not. Over by what amounted to the site's compost heap, a hillock of soil, decaying plants and vegetation that stunk to high heaven in the summer, was a metal box. That was definitely a fresh arrival, and an odd overnight discovery on several levels. First, there was its size. A big suitcase or a small packing case, depending on your point of view. It looked like it was made of black steel or something similar. Scuffed, as if it had been on a bit of a journey, heavy-looking anyway. Much too heavy to have been chucked over the fence and reached this far into the site. So Dave reasoned it had been left where it was for a purpose, which made no sense at all. Second, when he took a closer look, he could see that much of the metal was covered in rows of letters, numbers, and what he could only assume were coded symbols of some kind. Not the alphabet, anyhow. Every edge was plastered with circular markings that indicated some kind of warning. Toxic? Poisonous? None of it added up. They had special places for this sort of stuff, didn't they? Like 600 feet underground. And third, it was completely sealed. If there was an opening latch, Dave couldn't see it. He tried flipping it over onto the other side and was surprised by its sheer weight as it tumbled with a menacing thump to the ground. No, not the slightest indication of an opening mechanism or anything similar. Not by or inside the handles or, as far as he could see, along the hinge. Whatever was inside, if anything was inside, was not meant to be easily accessible, to say the least. Dave ran his finger around the criss-cross of indecipherable alphanumerics. What could it possibly be? No bloody idea. None at all. Tell! No response. His co-worker must have been still absorbed by the row on the radio. Tell! This time he was louder and Terry heard him, poking his head out of the door of the hut. What? He sounded mildly exasperated, as if his morning somehow had been fatally disrupted. Come and take a look at this! Then more quietly, for Christ's sake. Terry never rushed anywhere, and was certainly not going to break the habit of a lifetime early on a Thursday morning. Sauntering towards Dave, he said, What you found? A winning lottery ticket? Shite, Tell. Here, take a look at that. He gestured towards the big black case. Terry surveyed it, then knelt down to get a closer look. Bloody hell, he said. What the fuck is it? That's what I'm wondering, Muppet. Terry tried to lift it and was barely able to shift it from its prone position. Christ, it's heavy and on it. Something that definitely isn't normal junk in there. Exactly, said Dave. And how did it get there? That's what I'd like to know. He rubbed his hands together nervously out of habit. It's like it was left for someone to pick up, he paused again, which is pretty strange. But anyhow, they didn't collect it, did they? Terry ignored the question. All these numbers and stuff, it looks, I don't know, official, like government or corporate or something. Fucking weird. He stood up. I've never seen anything like it in 3 years here. You? Dave shook his head. No, and I've done almost six. I've got to say, I don't much like it, till let's call it in. He looked at the box again. I look at that thing, and my strongest feeling is, let's make it someone else's problem. Soon as. Sweet? Terry nodded. Took the words right out of my mouth, David, sir. And then he said, got your phone? Mine's bust. Charging on the desk, said Dave. They stomped back to the hut in lockstep, matching their shared determination to be rid of whatever that thing was as soon as humanly possible. Inside, Dave opened a drawer and handed Terry a form. Fill that in, will ya? It's standard when we involve a non-council authority. Tell shrugged. Will do, I guess. Jesus, more effing paperwork. Hello? Yes, police. Thank you. He waited to be connected. Yeah, hello, police. Hello, my name's Drayton. David Drayton. I work at Stepney... Yeah, that's right, sorry. D-R-A-Y-T-O-N. Yes, this number. He waited again. My colleague and myself have located an item on the site that is, well, not on any inventory or accounted for by either of us or by the local authority. We're a bit concerned by its presence, to be honest. No idea. No, it looks like it might be in a bit... scientific or whatever. What does it look like? Well, Dave did his best to describe the case and why it struck the two of them as odd. He feared for a moment that he was getting nowhere. Why am I concerned? Listen, we see all sorts here, trust me, mate, but this is not your ordinary East London silly o'clock fly tipping. Believe me, it's... Well, it looks like it might be dangerous, I suppose. What? No, neither of us are feeling unwell. Hold on, I'll ask my colleague. Tell? Terry shook his head silently. Nah, he's fine too. Yep, good as gold. We just both... Oh, great. So, you'll send a squad car. And when might that be? Really? Okay, well, the sooner the better. Thanks. Thanks very much. Bye. Terry looked at him inquiringly. In return, Dave could only muster a frown. Didn't sound like it was exactly high on their list, but then I guess it wouldn't be round here, would it? Thieving, gear. They've got bigger fish to fry, haven't they? All the same, I'd like to be rid of that thing. He pointed out at the grease-stained window of the hut. As soon as we can. One thing I've learned in this job is when something is above your pay grade, you don't want anything to do with it. And whatever is in that box definitely passes that test. Terry looked over his shoulder at the dump. I told you, it looks government, medical. Probably full of some god-awful new virus, you know. They're always working on the new ones, aren't they? In their labs. And we all know all too bloody well that accidents can happen, don't we? You hearing me, Dave? Now it was Dave's turn to play it cool. Oh, what are you banging on about? Viruses? Gaw, that last booster jab really has done your head in, hasn't it? Yeah, well, it's easy to be snarky, but look at what we all went through the last time. They said it came from a market or a bat or something. But it just happened to turn up in the city where they had all them deep cover labs. And we know that was at the mild end compared to some of the horrors. Oh, listen to yourself. You find a dodgy box in the middle of a dump in Stepney and suddenly you're seeing biological warfare breaking out. Pandemic, the sequel. You do have a vivid imagination, Terence, my son. Let's calm down and wait for the old bill to come and sort it all out, shall we? He could see that Terry was mildly peeved by the piss take. Look, let's have another cuppa and just wait it out, eh? He got up from his chair and went over to the sink to turn the kettle on. Then we can go for an early liquid lunch at the carpenter's and celebrate our exciting morning. I'm buying. At this prospect, Terry cheered up. Be rude not to, wouldn't it? Exactly. They sat in silence as the kettle boiled, listening to the traffic outside, the noise of kids on their way to school, and the distant rumble of a sound system being tested in one of the fashionable galleries that had clustered a few blocks away. What happened next mostly eluded Dave as he lay on his hospital bed and tried to remember. They were still gossiping, that much he recalled, and sipping their teas. And then, in his peripheral vision, something outside, a blur, fast, determined, heading towards them pitilessly. Next, the hut door smashed open, and there was a flurry of violent activity. He did remember a figure in a black balaclava hitting Terry hard on the head, interrupting the protest that was forming in his throat, and Terry slumping instantly to the ground. And just as Dave was himself saying, "What the f-?" an arm came round his neck, and a ferocious blow struck his temple that was both intensely painful and completely disorientating. But before he could absorb and think about how painful and disorientating it was, much less ask whoever was doing this to stop, another haymaker hit its mark. Then, everything was blackness. Chapter 2. Harry Taylor was trying to have a lie-in for, you reckon, the first time in 6 weeks. Not that he felt he'd earned it. If there was one thing he hated, it was unfinished business, and last night definitely qualified for that bloody annoying category, and then some. It made his bad leg ache. Every time he closed his eyes, he heard the whistle of bullets and the hiss of smoke grenades, the shouting of angry and wounded men, and the whine of an SUV speeding away. Chaos. A fucked-up operation, in short. For almost a year, he and his team had been chasing a seriously high-value target. The Crick Syndicate. The third-generation London villains ran a decent slice of protection, prostitution and narcotics in the capital. Two brothers, Lionel and Sweetie Ray, and a younger sister, Bren, had turned the old-fashioned Cockney firm into an international going concern that you could probably list on the stock exchange. But after God knows how many arrests over the years, not one of the three had been charged, much less sent down. True. A few of the lieutenants well down the food chain were already doing time at His Majesty's pleasure, some for decent stretches. But not one had flipped on the Cricks, understandably fearful of what would happen to their families if they did. Murder, assault, human trafficking, embezzlement, breaking and entering, conspiracy to defraud, the list went on. But an organisation like the Cricks could afford to lose a few junior bosses now and then, as long as they didn't squeal, which they never did. And that, as Harry had told his superiors at New Scotland Yard time and time again, was no bloody good. His years as a soldier taught him that to kill a target, a gang, a team of assassins, a rogue state, you had to aim for the head. Clean decapitation. Remove the leadership wherever it was, and often enough it was lurking in the shadows, which in this case meant Lionel, Sweetie, Bren, and a handful of top-dollar members of their inner circle, all of whom were now domiciled in Monaco, though they often flitted back to the city of their birth to keep an eye on their operations. Until the first team was taken off the streets, the syndicate would continue to thrive. The top brass, having spoken to their political masters, had finally given Harry the green light. The Crick Temple was to be brought crashing to the ground by all and any legal means available. "Clean the stables, DCI Taylor," said one assistant commissioner with an eye on a headline, not to mention the top job at the Met. Easier said than done, of course. The operation had involved many, many months of round-the-clock surveillance, both real-world and digital, as well as hours of painstaking trawling of documents and databases. For sure, Harry was happy to use all the mod cons the Met had to offer. Nothing wrong with a laptop. it always said, to make life easier as long as you didn't expect it to restrain and handcuff a psychopath. And yes, they'd used plenty of signals intelligence, some from overseas, and been happy for any help that the spooks had to offer, which in a couple of cases had been considerable. But it was undercover work. The boots on the ground, old-fashioned police work on the streets, stakeouts and the shaking down of informants, or persuasive discussions, as Harry described it in his reports to his superiors, that in the end had delivered the leads they needed. It was coppers, not algorithms, that had got them a shot at swooping down like hawks on the Crick's top team. Three strands had converged. A tip that a helicopter and private jet had been chartered very discreetly at the last minute to take a group from Furnival Commodities from Monaco to Nice and then on to London City. Furnival, it transpired, was a shell company formerly owned by two Parisian lawyers, but, in reality, according to Five, a front for Crick operations. Second, the National Crime Agency, NCA, had mid-grade intelligence that there was going to be some sort of auction in London, with interested parties from the underworld or their most trusted representatives allegedly converging upon the capital to inspect the lot, whatever it was, and bid for it. No further information on what it was or who was coming, but it made the Crick's apparent snap visit to town more interesting. What were they after? And who might they be bidding against? And third, a corrupt customs officer had spilled the beans about a large shipment of high-quality heroin due to be shipped in a container to Dover the following day. He was in on the deal for £50,000 to clear his gambling debts, in return for which he had to do everything in his power to get the goods off the boat and across the border, which led Harry and his team to the customs officer's contact, known only as Jericho, a mid-level drug dealer who was lying low in Folkestone awaiting orders. He was also a vicious pimp, with a rap sheet the length of his arm. But more to the point, he was a junkie, supposedly clean for 2 years, but who'd recently relapsed and was desperately in need of a fix when Harry's two closest lieutenants, D.I. John Williams and D.S. Iris Davis, got to him. At last, they had a weak link, and knew something that the Cricks obviously didn't. There was a pressure point to which they could apply, well, pressure. After 3 years with Harry, first as sergeant before making DI, John appeared to have grown used to the famed Taylor temper and the outbursts of rage that were provoked by anything that seemed sloppy, second-rate or negligent. Despite what it looked like to outsiders, it was all part of Harry's M.O., his way of managing the task in hand, as well as the people he was responsible for. When the year before, John's wife had decided that life with a well-heeled chartered accountant might be more fulfilling than living with a mostly absent copper, and had taken the kids with her, Harry had said nothing, but slapped his DI reassuringly on the back and kept him on an even keel, checking in on John regularly, and dragging him along to Stamford Bridge for a home game or boxing nights at York Hall in Bethnal Green. If John had ever been stupid enough to accuse his boss of being emotionally intelligent, his reward would have been a fat lip. Harry hated psychobabble, self-indulgence, and worst of all, any mention of wellness almost as much as he loathed criminals. But he had a heart, not that you'd ever guess it from his regular manner. Harry had always known that John would make it to the other side of the Crick case, as exhausting and nerve-wracking as it undoubtedly had been. But for Sergeant Iris Davis, it had been a test of a different order. Still only 32, 6 or 7 years younger than John, she had been with Harry's team only a year, promoted to the Met after rolling up an extortion racket case in the West Midlands. She had incredible promise, and Harry didn't doubt for a second that she'd one day make assistant commissioner without breaking sweat, and maybe rise higher. But he had hope that her pen-pushing years wouldn't start too soon, because her talents as a police officer were certain, in his strong opinion, to be wasted behind a desk. She was a trained sniper too, a natural on the ranges, her instructors said. Capable of concentrating totally for 10 hours in a field op nest while awaiting a go or not in her earpiece. What use would all that be in a seminar on community policing or at a London Assembly committee hearing? Despite this, Harry hadn't been certain that she'd be ready for the final punishing months of the Crick operation. But when it came to it, she had exceeded all expectations, including, perhaps, her own. On night after night of stakeouts over sleepless weekends, poring over crooked accounts with her finance bods, and, during one interrogation when she had punched a long-time Crick associate hard in the face after he made a crack about Afghan bitches dying in containers while he was out on bail, she had shown Harry that she had what it took to be a first-rank copper, on the street as well as in the conference room or at a bank or computer screens. She was, if he was honest, quite something. And though he could barely admit it to himself, he found himself enjoying her company more and more. As it turned out, Jericho broke in less than half an hour, which John noted at the time was probably a record, even for Harry. You didn't even have to tickle him, Gov. Under a naked light bulb in his own basement, sweating and shaking from dope sickness, Jericho had told them all they needed to know. Yes, the Crick siblings were headed to London. He didn't know which of them, though. Yes, their two top men, Barry Sales and Long Charlie Watkins, would peel off to Folkestone to examine the shipment and, assuming it was up to snuff, authorise the transfer of however many millions to whoever was selling the gear. Harry got up and stretched, touched his toes with gratifying ease and checked the state of play in the mirror by the bed. Not too bad, all things considered. A bit green round the gills, a body bearing a bunch of scars that told a whole book of stories, but all things considered, still in decent shape, especially considering what had happened the night before. He had turned 45 a month before and, though he admitted this to nobody, he was starting to feel it. Not exactly losing a pace just yet, he sensed nonetheless that he might do so quite soon. The aches and pains of the job were taking just a little longer to get over than they used to. Even so, he could still get by just fine on 3 or 4 hours a night, exactly as he had when it was his turn to grab some kip during an op in Helmand, though he'd never slept properly when he was in Afghanistan. Not really. If you knew what was good for you, you kept one eye open for the Taliban blade that would, and did, come flashing in the night. No room for mistakes against that lot. And no room for mistakes when your adversaries were as practiced and brutal as the Cricks. And yet that had him wondering, were the mistakes of the night before his fault? Harry had thought he had it taped. From a temporary command post at Shawncliffe Army Camp, he had watched on a live feed as the Bombardier Challenger 350 had landed at City Airport and, bullseye, all the Crick siblings, Sales, Watkins and three heavies had disembarked, split into three groups and had been whisked away in black Bentley Bentaygas at 1:10 a.m. precisely.
"Eyes on all vehicles, sir,"
Harry had heard in his earpiece. "All right, Dasher," Harry said. "Follow all three and radio in anything interesting. Hang back, but don't lose them." Bill Dasher Brown was the surveillance chief back at New Scotland Yard and had known Harry for years. It had been good to have him on their team on that night of all nights. John looked up from the laptop. "The helos need to steer clear, Harry. We've got 8 vehicles down there. If they see they're being watched, don't worry," he said. "Dasher won't let us down."
"Alpha team,"
said the voice in his ear. "What's the latest?"
"Looks like vehicles 1 and 2 are heading for the embankment."
"Makes sense," said Harry. "The Cricks have a penthouse near Lambeth Palace. Probably their first stop of the night. Pick up some hairspray."
"We'll have eyes on them all the way. Vehicle 3 is heading east towards you."
"That'll be Sales and Watkins. Roger that, Dasher." He turned to Iris. "Any joy from the hackers?" She checked her screen. The hackers were a strange group of spotty kids, barely in their 20s, who occupied a fetid room on the 3rd floor at Thames House and tried to hack into whatever system they were told to. anything really, from a bank in Moscow to a TikTok account in Cardiff, but in this case the GPS system of the three luxury SUVs. "Not yet," she said. "Oh, hold on. Vehicle 3. The teen geniuses have just intercepted the coordinates. Where are those bastards heading? Wait a second, Gov. There it is. East Cliff and Warren Country Park. Very nice, too." She showed Harry pictures of the location. Idyllic woodlands, country trails, wildlife and picnic spots for family visits. "Plenty of cover," he said. "Makes sense for a rendezvous." "Only 10 minutes away from here," she said. "John, you've got the comms," Harry said. "Iris and I will head down there now. Get us back up lickety-split, OK? We need full tactical as predicted. This might get quite busy. I don't think this lot will crumble in the face of harsh language." Harry and Iris were already wearing body armour and she was strapped with the Heckler & Koch G36. He had a Glock 26 in his holster. There was every chance that they might need them. Sales and Watkins would not give up without a fight. And as to the people they were meeting, well, that was a known unknown, dangerously so. "Any update on the auction, John?" Harry asked. "All quiet. Could be a dud steer, you know. I mean, auctioning what? It's hardly fucking Sotheby's." "We'll see. Keep it tight here and loop us in on anything, anything at all. This is our night, John. We get to take those scumbags down at last. Right?" "Roger that," said John, and turned back to the bank of screens in which the three Bentleys and a series of locations flashed into view. Two guards from the Gurkha's 2nd Battalion had stood outside the hut, silent and unflinching. Harry and Iris had climbed into their unmarked police Range Rover and sped off, slowing down only to be let out at the exit checkpoint, where crash barriers and multiple gates kept the menacing world at bay. Gurkhas, Harry knew, left nothing to chance.
"The rendezvous is a small lay-by with a shelter gravel parking area. Looks like it might be a cafe during the day,"
said John on the comms.
"Crick Vehicle 3 is 25 to 30 minutes away."
"Any activity nearby?" Harry asked.
"Nothing yet. Dasher has a unit patrolling in the neighbourhood that will do a run past and send images. Cheltenham satellites say nothing to report."
"Roger that." The park was indeed only 10 minutes from the camp, and they ditched the Range Rover off-road near a large Victorian building that looked like a small research centre or small corporate branch. Harry and Iris walked the last 100 yards, flashlights off, hugging the tree line on the other side of the road.
"Tactical in place,"
said John, over the radio.
"Three units within a minute away from the site. Fourth unit 2 minutes out. Plenty more if you need it."
"Roger that." Harry and Iris found a small shed with a brick wall and took cover.
"Well, hello,"
John said.
"Got a bloody motorcade heading your way from the east."
"From Dover? Where from?" said Harry. "Can you retrace its steps on CCTV?
"Doing that. Running the plates through now. No, this lot came from a headland, not a port. Looks like they started their journey about 8 miles west of Dover. Doesn't tell us where the package arrived initially, of course."
"Leave that till later, John. Focus on the meat and who's heading towards us."
"Crick Vehicle 3 is very warm indeed now. A quarter click from you."
"Standing by," said Harry. "All units on standby, ready on my command." He and Iris remained crouched behind the wall, Harry's pulse throbbing in his temples. This was it. After all these years, the chance to bring down one of the last great homegrown London gangs and make the city, the whole country, just a little bit safer. But he couldn't let that dream distract him. For now, Harry needed to stay frostier than Olaf's arse. 2 a.m. The lay-by was suddenly bathed in light as three identical black BMW X SUVs swung into the gravelled parking bay. Before Harry and Iris could check plates, the darkness returned, and the silence became deafening. Iris pulled down her night vision goggles. "I can make out 2 plates, I think. Yes, UK, 2022 Reg. I'll send you John now."
"Crick Vehicle 3 approaching,"
said John in their earpieces. "Roger that," said Harry. "All units, await my go." The Bentley purred into the woodland clearing and across their line of sight. for what seemed like an eternity but was no more than a minute. The occupants of the four vehicles hung tight. Then, as if they could bear the suspense no longer, the driver and front passenger of the first BMW got out and walked towards the brick building. They were tall, wearing leather jackets and jeans, dark-haired and seemed younger than he had expected. They had the bearing of trusted middlemen, rather than the underboss or consigliere. In response, the Bentley disgorged all four of its passengers. Harry immediately recognised Long Charlie Watkins from his lumbering silhouette, suited and booted, as always, a rich man in his own right these days, though still quite happy when the job required it, to pull out a few fingernails for old time's sake. "I have eyes on Watkins," said Harry. "And fuck me. This is other half, Barry Sales. Well, well, he's a sight for sore eyes." Sales was wiry, sly, edgy, smaller than Watkins, but no less deadly. Electrodes had been his speciality back in the day. Legend had it that he would play Charlie Parker on full blast to drown out the screams of his victims. The two sides strode towards one another and exchanged some sort of greeting. But it was all business, no bonhomie. By their body language, Long Charlie and Barry didn't like being out in the open one bit. They wanted to do the necessary and get away as fast as humanly possible. But their very presence showed how important this meeting was. Sales and Watkins followed the two mystery men towards the first BMW and waited as they opened the boot. Charlie raised a gloved finger to beckon one of his hooded heavies to join him. After a brief pause, the hood took something in his hand and headed back to the Bentley. "He's testing the gear," said Harry. "This should be fun." "How do you know?" said Iris. "I don't, not for sure, but I bet I'm right." He breathed deeply. "Okay. On my mark. If they give any sort of go-ahead, all units to move in, arrest all present, assume all suspects are armed, extreme vigilance." His task, whatever it was, now complete, the crick hood stepped back out of the Bentley and gave a thumbs up to Sales and Watkins. This was it. "All units go," said Harry. The few minutes that followed that pivotal moment had already become a blur in Harry's memory as he sat on the edge of the bed the following morning. The lay-by had suddenly been flooded in light by the tactical team. A warning through a megaphone ordered the crooks to hit the deck and wait to be cuffed. Shots were fired immediately, first from the BMWs, then by the crick heavies. Iris took both of them out in the first 30 seconds. They fell like twisted mannequins, riddled with bullets. Sales made a run for it, but Harry got him in the leg and, recklessly he knew, ran out to grab him and drag him back to their cover. "No," Harry had thought, "you're one little rat that's definitely going to live in a cage from now on." He heard the distinctive pop of a smoke grenade hurled from God knows where. "Cover up," he yelled to Iris. She pulled up a mask. Sales began to cough. "And you can shut up and all," Harry yelled at him. The lay-by, so still only seconds previously, had become a scene of bedlam. The comms feed was jammed with updates, some conflicting. Harry could feel the bullets slicing through the air. This was not how he had wanted it to go. Not even close. "I have Sales," Harry shouted. "All units report on status."
"Unit Bravo here. We have one officer down, two of theirs also down, I think. Their beamers are revving up to go, counting four hostiles inside plus Watkins still unaccounted for."
"Tell Unit Charlie to pursue," Harry said. "John, scramble more backup. Stat!" With a screech, three of the BMWs raced into the night, kicking up dust in their wake. The air was thick, and it took a few minutes for the smoke and dust to clear enough to reveal the aftermath of the battle. Two of the BMW's squad were indeed dead. Harry cursed as the scene revealed another body, Watkins, apparently shot at close range, which suggested that his new business partner suspected a double cross. To Harry's fury, the BMWs lost the police tail about 4 miles out. The vehicles turned up in a Folkestone NCP the next morning and were towed away by SCD4, the Met's forensic services team. Harry doubted that they would find much, some DNA perhaps, even that wasn't a slam dunk. Professional criminals were so careful these days, and only a relatively small percentage of them were on the DNA database. Yes, they had sales. He would go down for a long time, thanks to the impressively pure heroin sample still in the bloodstream of his unidentified colleague's dead body. Proof enough that this had been a big smack deal. But he would never talk. He had two daughters, one of whom ran an upmarket florist in Chelsea, while the other was studying English at St. Andrews. If he so much as breathed a word about the Cricks, both girls would be dead in 24 hours. Nothing his interrogators said to him about protecting them moved him in the slightest. Not yet charged, he already had the countenance of a man who knew he was going to die in prison. And the three Crick siblings? They were indeed in their embankment penthouse, vexed to be visited by detectives at such a late hour, though they were still up at 3 a.m. and, curiously enough, accompanied in the middle of the night by two of their lawyers. Questioned under caution, Lionel, Sweetie and Bren denied all knowledge of the Foulston deal. Yes, they employed the late Mr. Watkins and the unfortunate Mr. Sales as part of their security team, but they all said, shocked to hear of this alleged connection with the narcotics trade, which they found hard to believe, but of course deplored. They themselves were in London to see some properties they were thinking of adding to their family portfolio. Hence, they said, the presence of their lawyers, who had worked late and stayed for some food and a glass of champagne. And the three of them hoped to attend a niece's birthday party in Chiswick the next day. A marquee and all the trimmings. An auction? No, they knew nothing about that either. An auction of what, exactly? Yes, it was true that they had started to dip their toe into the art market, but that was all managed by an experienced agent who did most of his business in Paris. The mask slipped only once, at the very end of the interview. Shown to the door by Bren, the two detectives, through gritted teeth, wished them good night. And Lionel finally snarled, "Why don't you just fuck off out of our home, you filthy fucking coppers?" By then, Harry was at home, trying to get some sleep before the morning debrief. He knew that the Yard would already be spinning the whole thing as a triumph, the interception of a top-level gangland meeting after months of surveillance, the arrest of a senior mobster now facing multiple life sentences, the gunning down of Long Charlie, a legendary villain, ideal for lurid profiles in the Red Tops, and two, as yet, unidentified criminal associates, believed to be Albanian, and, to give emotional depth to the story, the death in the line of duty of a brave tactical officer, now named as 25-year-old Constable Jai Bari. As Harry sat on his bed the following morning, he saw only failure. Watkins dead. What use was that? All three Cricks still at large, and unlikely to stick their head above the parapet again any time soon. And a young copper taken out in a messy firefight. Sure, Sales would do his time, God rot him. But it had not been the night he had been hoping for. The stables had not been cleaned. It was a fucking mess, and that was on him. His phone rang at 10 a.m, and he immediately recognised the voice on the other end of the line.
"All right, Sleeping Beauty,"
said DCS Bill Robinson at the end of the line.
"Thought you might have a cushy one today, did you?"
"It had crossed my mind, Gov, yes," Harry mumbled.
"Well, forget it. Get your ass into work now."
He was about to ring off, but added,
"Oh, and Harry?"
"Yeah."
"It might be an idea to check the news on your way in."
Chapter 3. Most of Harry's colleagues couldn't believe he still drove an XJS. Jaguar had stopped making those beautiful beasts in 1996, and they guzzled about a gallon of petrol a mile. They were hardly the most practical of motors for police work either. Try squeezing a 6'6" coke dealer into a coupe, which meant that Harry often had to use a police pool car when he was on the job, and, as far as the younger members of staff were concerned, the ownership of such a motor in the first place was as close as you could get to announcing, "I don't give a toss about climate change." short of plastering a sticker across the bumper reading, "I hate Greta Thunberg." Harry didn't hate Greta Thunberg, but he did like classic cars, and he'd be damned if anyone was going to tell him what he could or couldn't drive. Though he was bracing himself for the painful inevitable when, as the new laws on what cars you could and couldn't use on the road took hold, there might come a time when he would have to arrest himself. Until then, the XJS was one of the few unambiguous luxuries in which he indulged. It made for good camouflage, too. Cops in the 2020s weren't supposed to drive flash motors. They weren't supposed to do much, when he thought about it. Stick to a set of rules that hemmed them in more and more every year, wear body cameras at all times, mug up on the Equality Act, think twice before saying anything lest a suspect report a hate incident to their superiors. In all the new clobber and with all the regulations, they weren't really coppers anymore, half robots, half bureaucrats, at least in Harry's book. Not that he had any time for real dinosaurs. He hated bent police officers and racist or sexist talk in the canteen. But he also hated being treated like a kid by people who had never felt a bullet brush half an inch past their ear or taken cover from mortar fire, as he'd done for 10 hours straight in Tora Bora. Two of his mates had died that day. Another thing Harry hated was the phrase "old school copper," especially when applied to him, as it often was round the Met. Yes, he liked to get the job done. Yes, he could throw a punch as well as take one. And no, he didn't think police officers were social workers or local politicians. Their job was law enforcement, pure and simple, not therapy. All the same, he wasn't Dixon of Doc Green, for Christ's sake, or John Thorne of Sweeney. Harry had grown up during the 80s and knew all about social strife and what it was like to see poor, powerless people treated badly by the authorities. It was vile. He had only been 3 when his neighbourhood was traumatised by the New Cross Fire of 1981, in which 13 young black people had been killed, and nobody had been charged, much less prosecuted. He had seen the British movement marching and felt his stomach turn at the hatred they were spreading. More than a lot of the middle-class people who came to the Met to teach courses on this ism or that bias, he had seen the ugly side of life close up and had nothing but contempt for those who fanned the flames of bigotry. He didn't need a special course to coach him on what he had already learned firsthand. In fact, it only ended up in the police service by accident. Enlisting in the army as soon as he left school, he was talent spotted in the ranks of the Irish Guards after 4 years and encouraged to apply for recruitment to the SAS. A test of endurance and grit like no other he had ever experienced, and one that, when he had passed, he was determined never to subject himself to again. Some chance, of course. Life in a brown beret in Hereford was a combination of anxious waiting and bursts of unbelievable activity, most of which never reached the public domain at all, much less the newspapers or TV bulletins. In Helmand and Colombia, Georgia, Myanmar, he had served Queen and Country in operations that ranged from exfiltration — how had that stupid diplomat got himself kidnapped in the jungle — to lightning strikes on terrorist encampments, acting on human intelligence that, he and his troop mates knew, had been gathered by assets risking their very lives and would be actionable for only a few hours. He'd put field dressings on plenty of wounds, helped to airlift civilians out of disaster zones, and watched too many of his comrades die in action. Yes, Harry Taylor had seen the world all right. And then, one blazing day at Camp Bastion, the sun starting to set but still doing its work, he had been properly crocked on the right knee by one of his best mates, Sergeant Jim Jawbone Jackson. Well and truly floored, in a game of five-a-side, for Christ's sake. Jawbone had laughed when Harry first hit the deck, swearing blue murder, but had stopped pretty sharpish when he realised that his friend couldn't stand, and that, the medic had quickly warned, the damage to his knee would put Harry out of commission for a fair bit. Two surgeries later, one back at a specialist hospital in London, a fair bit had turned into indefinitely. Although the knee would heal just fine, he was still a young man. It might also give way at any time, which was a possibility that he knew the regiment could never countenance. Nor could he, to be fair. And so Harry was faced with a grim choice, one of the decisions that was part and parcel of the life he had chosen. What were his options? What future faced Harry Taylor as he picked at the plaster cast encasing his leg, on which his mates had scrawled obscenities and "get well soon, you prick" messages? He would never be passed as fit for a troop op, that much was clear. He could stay a soldier but return to his original regiment and accept a desk job with no prospect of getting back in the field. Or he could leave the army and see what Civvy Street had to offer a man who had literally been kicked out of the special forces. As he said at his bastion leaving do, "It was a tackle that got me, not the Taliban." And that was that. He left soldiering behind and, as he healed and recovered his fitness, he was back to running half marathons within 6 months of his return to the UK, wondered what to do with the rest of his life. What did he have to show for his 30 years on Earth? A few medals? Some seriously classified memories and a bit of money put away for a deposit on a flat? You don't spend much of your salary when you're dodging bullets in the desert. But no wife or kids, and none in prospect. Women passed through his life from time to time, usually departing on amicable terms, but always making clear on the way out that they wanted more of him, more commitment. Though not exactly film star handsome, he was a lean 6'2" with a shock of thick dark hair and strong features that girlfriends had described variously as Roman, hawkish, and in the words of Dee Dee, the hairdresser from Peckham, fucking fit. He went on dates, enjoyed the company of women, but never seemed to make it to the next stage, or anything like a life partnership. They said he was married to the job. And they were right, weren't they? Because in what his old man called one of your frying pan to fire manoeuvres, he had applied to join the police 3 months after getting back from Afghanistan and signing off in Hereford. What else was he going to do? Work in sales, sing and dance? For a man with his CV, there was always those dodgy security firms with anonymous offices in Mayfair, outfits run by public schoolboys that, describing themselves as contractors, provided all manner of wicked services all over the world for a price. Harry was proud to have been a soldier, but he knew the difference between a soldier and a mercenary. Come to think of it, he'd always known, if only subconsciously, that he would end up as a copper if, for whatever reason, he left the army. In his first months back home, he was badly afflicted by insomnia, so badly that he went to a doctor who said it was common enough in veterans and prescribed sleeping pills, and those just made Harry feel groggy most of the time, which was not the idea at all. It was only after he flushed the pills down the loo and thought about his predicament that he realised that he had the problem the wrong way round. He wasn't suffering from a surfeit of adrenaline. He missed it. The next day, he had filed an application to join the police service. The best decision he had ever made, he freely admitted to anyone who would listen. Because, for all its frustrations, his second career had spared him from living forever in the shadow of his first. And he had prospered as a copper, thanks in no small part to the guidance and patronage of the man he was on his way to see now, Detective Chief Superintendent Bill Robinson. As the car glided out of the garage and he turned right into Barra High Street, he switched on the radio. The LBC presenter was speaking with a breathless reporter on location somewhere.
"And that's all we know so far, is it, Ben?" "Yes. That's what we've been told so far, though we're expecting a press conference later in the day, possibly with Met Commissioner Sir Mohammed Bakwi." "How many people have been evacuated? Well, we don't have an exact number yet, Gavin, but my sources tell me it's between 60 and 100. Most of the blocks that have been sealed off are unoccupied or would have been full of construction teams, all of which have obviously been stood down for the day, pending clearance from the police. Just to reassure listeners, Ben, there hasn't been an incident as such. No, not as far as we know. There were reports about an hour ago of a bomb disposal unit using a remote robotic rig, but these, I'd stress, are unconfirmed. Also, plenty of police officers in hazmat suits, and I've seen them myself, moving in and out of the area. Tell us what that means, Ben.
The reporter paused for a beat.
Well, I'd emphasise that I'm speculating here, Gavin, as we really need to wait for the Met's briefing, but such suits can indicate concern about some sort of chemical or toxic waste spill. That's one scenario. But I'd really underline that this is only hypothesis right now. And what is the mood like down in Stepney? Well, half an hour ago it was pandemonium. I counted 15 fire engines and a similar number of ambulances. Crowds being dispersed. The tube station is still closed and there are plenty of pedestrians and traffic being rerouted out of the sealed-off zone. I'd say that whatever it is, the relevant agencies have some idea of what they're up against and are trying to reduce the number of people in the area as they get on with whatever they're getting on with. Do we know if there's going to be a Cobra meeting today?
Having had enough of Gavin and Ben for the time being, Harry turned off the car radio, checked the regular police frequencies on his in-vehicle comms and then his phone. No further units were now being dispatched to Stepney, which meant that the relevant specialist teams and agencies were already on the case, and made it slightly odd that Robinson should be calling him in at all. As the lights at the next junction turned red, he skimmed some of the news sites. Breaking. 6 blocks of East London sealed off by police was the BBC's lead headline, while the Times had Met briefing on East End closure imminent, PM receiving regular updates. The Sun app had stuck with a supposedly big scoop about a strictly love rat scandal. Harry had worked out some of it already. Sealing off an area was much more commonplace than people imagined, especially in a big city. Most went unreported, not because they were secret, but because the closure came and went so quickly. He had been involved in a drill himself 2 years before in which a neighbourhood in Manchester was closed down for an hour to permit a pretty half-hearted exercise in preparation for a local outburst of civil conflict. The residents and community leaders had been warned to expect a spot of disruption of their Wednesday afternoon. Low-flying helos, reconnaissance vehicles and police support units for riot control. But most just gawped at the spectacle, which was all over in 45 minutes. In any case, whatever was happening in Stepney was definitely not a drill. It had already been briefed to the media, which meant that whoever was running Gold Command was trying to get out ahead of the story before what the suits called an unhelpful narrative got a grip on social media. Twitter, Facebook and Getter would already be fizzing with conspiracy theories and wild claims. But, in such situations, the majority of the public still took their cue from mainstream channels and would be watching and listening to regular news for updates. Those outlets had clearly been told to stand by for more information and, it seemed, nudged slightly towards the idea of a toxic spill that would keep disaster tourists at bay, at least for the time being. It was serious, that much was clear. But not so serious, Harry noted, that a news blackout had been imposed, or at the other extreme that a snap emergency statement had been made, explicitly instructing people to keep away at all costs and to expect worse to come. Instead, there was just enough coquettish menace in the toxic spill line, wherever that came from, to make the public take it seriously, but not so much that London would descend into panic. Yes, serious, but manageable, he would say. He drove down St. George's Road past the sunken majesty of the Cathedral and Lambeth North Station, where he had once headbutted a suspect into unconsciousness, and up past the Park Plaza Hotel, where the politicians stayed during election campaign season, protection officers with them, over Westminster Bridge, before turning sharp right and cruising towards his destination, New Scotland Yard. SO22 had its base on the sixth floor, just by the lift waiting area. When Robinson had announced 4 years before that the new unit was to be located in such a prominent part of the Met's HQ, Harry had immediately objected. The whole point, he said, of the new SO team, one whose existence would not be secret but would certainly not be loudly advertised, was to stay on the down low, keep a modest profile away from the office gossips and the politics. Why not make a den for the new team in the vacant tobacco dock premises that the commissioner was talking about putting on the commercial market? It would be perfect for what the architects of SO22, Harry among them, had in mind. "You know what your problem is?" Robinson had replied. "Correction, one of your problems?" "I have a horrible feeling you're going to tell me," Harry said. "Too right. Your instincts always did serve you well, all those patrols in the jungle. One of your problems, Harry, is that you lack imagination." Harry was having no trouble imagining giving Robinson a smack as it happened, but he decided not to clarify the point. "Right, Guff, how's that, may I ask?" "Well, here's the thing. We could hide away in a sweet little spot all on our own, miles from here. All the flash stuff, new glass walls, brand new tech, no distractions, just the business of stopping villains. We could do that. But do you know why that would be the prat move to make?" "Again, I have a weird premonition that you're going to bring me up to speed." Robinson spun round on his chair, his not quite nice suit bulging around a gut that showed a bit too openly how many years had passed since he'd been active in the field, although, fair play to the man, he'd been an operational legend at his peak. "I certainly am. Here's the reality. What we're doing here is being badged as an ancillary unit, or a wild card elite team for special projects. Something additional to all the specialist units that already exist, right?" "Not a threat to them," Harry nodded. "But you and I both know that's absolute fucking bollocks. SO22 came into being because a few of us, from ministerial level down, including you from the earliest stages, I might add, were fed up with a Met that had lost its balls, lost its focus, and was too busy covering its arse to make the calls that got proper bad guys behind bars. With me so far?" "I think I'm just about following." "And the very decision to call into being such a unit," Robinson said, "was a reproach. No, more like a fuck you to at least half of the other units in this building. Even using the old school SO handle, it sent a message. It was the Commissioner's way of saying, the Prime Minister's way of saying, for that matter, that there had to be a new elite unit to do what the other teams patently couldn't quite manage and, in particular circumstances, to get the job done when others were blethering on about how hard it all was. Everyone knows that the very existence of SO22 is a rebuke to most of the people working in this building." "And so," said Harry, "and so those people hate our guts on principle, before we've even started. They're longing for SO22 to fail, and the most spectacular the failure, the better." He paused. "And we won't always get it right, will we?" Harry shrugged. "I suppose not. Which is why I need us to be here, in the thick of it, protecting our people and making sure the sharks don't get what they want. And so do you, Harry. I know you'd rather be away from all the suits and the meetings and the procrastination. I get that, and believe me, I feel your pain. You're a great copper. And one of the things that makes you great is that you hate to waste time and all that."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.